Good morning, church. I want to welcome all of you once again to our live stream service. It is exciting that you have joined us this morning, and we are grateful that you have joined with us here as we worship the Lord together. It's always a blessing wherever we are to be able to worship God and to sing praises to His name and rejoice in all that the Lord does in our lives. Let me share with you as we get started today that beginning next Sunday on the 14th, there will be three opportunities for you to come and be here with us in person. And those opportunities are going to be at 10:30 next Sunday morning, 6 o'clock next Sunday evening, and then at 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening. All three of these will be the same service, so whichever one you come to, you'll be getting the same message and all that. But yet, we encourage you to contact Karen White at the office this week, either by telephone or by email, and make your reservation for one of these services, as we will be somewhat limited on the numbers that we can have in the building at one particular time. So I want to encourage you to make those reservations. I really look forward to seeing you all again. It's going to be much nicer preaching to you than to a camera, but nonetheless, we're excited that you're going to be a part of these services. If you feel that you can't come, and we certainly understand this because some are vulnerable and should not be coming out at a time such as this, we're going to continue the live stream at 10:30 each week, so you'll be able to still watch the service from home if you feel that you need to do that, and we encourage you to keep watching and keep participating in that way. Well, without any further delay, we are grateful to have this opportunity to start our service now, and I want to begin with a word of prayer. Will you pray with me? Loving, gracious God, we are so thankful for this beautiful morning you've given to us. The air is fresh, and we are excited that we can come into this place to worship you once again. And wherever we are, we pray, Lord, that as we gather this day as the body of Christ, that even though we may be distant from one another, we are still one. We are still together. We are still the church. And we are able to come together in this way to worship you in spirit and truth. Thank you, dear Lord, for your presence with us this day. And thank you for all those who have continued to work so faithfully to make these services possible. And we look forward, Lord, to that opportunity that we will have beginning next week of joining together as the body of Christ once again. And while things will look different, things will feel different. It's going to be a blessing just to be in one another's presence again. And I ask, Lord, that you will just keep us safe in this process and in this journey, that we might be able to gather as we will and worship you and rejoice that we have the fellowship with one another. Thank you, Lord, for being with us this day. And I especially want to lift up Jeremy as he prepares to bring the word to us this day. And I ask, Lord, that you will just give him the very words we need in this time. And be with Janae as she shares her children's time with us, as well as music today. And we just ask that you will bless her in a special way. And Mike, for his commitment to this church and his willingness to share this remarkable talent with us week after week. Lord, it's such a blessing that we can be a part of this service together. And now we ask in the name of Christ that you will guide us and keep us as we worship together in Jesus' name. Amen.
My Father's word. Good morning. I'm glad you could join us this morning. Today, when Jeremy told me what he was going to preach on today, I got really excited. You know why? We've been talking about it for a whole month. So if you guys have been watching on Wednesday, then you guys are so prepared to learn even more about what Jeremy has to share with us today. We're talking about going and sharing God with everyone. We've been working on this for 5 weeks. We've done all kinds of things. We've learned how God told us to go and he gave us a mission. We learned how God gave us the Holy Spirit to help us in all things. We learned how he gave us the armor of God so that we have everything we need to do his work. He gave us peace and joy to protect our hearts and our minds so that we can go and do your work. And this week we learned, which you guys are smart, you know, that prayer is a way for us to help everyone, even when it feels like we can't do much at all. There are so many ways we can go and do God's work, and God makes sure that we have everything we need, all the tools that we could use, and just he surrounds us with his power and his mercy and his grace so that we can go and do our mission. So my friends, if you didn't see all those videos, you can go back and watch them and learn more about how we can go and do God's work all through the world, even if it starts in your own house. All right, guys, let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us a mission so that we can do your work, so we can share your love and your hope and your joy and all the goodness and mercy that you have given us with the whole world, because God, it is for everyone. God, help us to be strong and brave and do what is right and good. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We come now to a time of sharing our joys and concerns, and today I want to lift up just a few prayer requests for you. First of all, I would like to ask you to remember Evelyn Martin in the loss of her sister, Ember. That funeral service will be this afternoon in Beckley, West Virginia, so please keep Evelyn in your prayers and Ember's husband, Mark, as well. And we also want to lift up John Martin. John has been in the hospital this week. He is home now, and we're grateful for that. And we ask continued prayers for John as he has been dealing with some issues this week with his heart. So we want to lift him up. And also I want to just say a special word in the loss of our dear friend Alan Hara. Alan, as all of you know, was a tremendous part of this church, giving us a tremendous gift in this wonderful organ, and we are so thankful for his life, and we know now that he is at rest with the Lord and that he is fully restored, and we're grateful for that. But please keep his family and this church family in your prayers in the loss of Alan. Now at this time, let's join our hearts in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, it is with grateful hearts that we come before you this day to pause and give you thanks for the countless blessings of life, to pause and just say how much we love you and how much it means to us that you love us. Lord, we are grateful for this church, for its ministries, for those who have stayed right in here with us through this time of pandemic and kept these services coming week after week. No, not everything has worked perfectly all the time, but Lord, we are grateful for what we can do and grateful for the opportunity to continue to share your word, and a time of worship when we can all gather together no matter where we are, and still be one family. Thank you, dear Lord, for your presence this day. Thank you for your presence with everyone who is watching right now and everyone who will watch in the hours and the days to come. Lord, today as we pause in this time of prayer, we do want to lift up Evelyn and the loss of her sister. We want to lift up Mark as well. And we want to lift up John, and we're grateful that he is out of the hospital now. And Lord, in this time of loss, we lift up Alan's family, and indeed Alan's family here in this church. People who loved him and cared for him, people that he loved in return. And Lord, we continue to pray for our nation this day, that you will somehow touch the hearts and lives of every person in this country, that we might desire to live together in peace and harmony. And Lord, thank you for all that you are doing among us. Lord, this is a great day. It's a great day because we have the opportunity to worship you. And Lord, in these moments, we only simply want to express our thanksgiving and praise for all that you do. And we thank you, Lord, that in this day, you are with us, you're encouraging us, you're keeping us strong, and you're helping us, Lord, through these most difficult times. As we prepare, Lord, next week to resume in-person worship, I pray, Lord, that we will do so with the utmost of wisdom, and that we will do so in a way that will keep us all safe and yet bring us together again. So, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your presence. And thank you for the joy that you bring to our hearts. And now I invite all of you to join me in this time of prayer as we pray that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples long ago when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Oh Lord, these are wonderful words. Wonderful words that speak to our hearts. And we ask, Lord, that you will forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. Today's reading of the scripture is coming from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. Would you hear these words? Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Jesus came near and spoke to them, "I've received all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Look, I myself will be with you every day until the end of the present age." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Now, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, starts and ends with some promises. To me, when I look at this entire chapter, I think of all the promises that have come and that have ended this chapter. You see, it starts off by Jesus fulfilling that promise he made long ago that he would die, and after 3 days, he would be resurrected. Sure enough, the women went to the tomb that day, and he was not there. He was raised from the dead. You see, this was just one of the promises that God had made over the years concerning the Messiah. You see, God promised for years that he would send his Son, and the Savior did come in Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus would then end today's scripture with another promise about another coming of his time, a promise that we can depend on because it's from a God who we can trust and believe. So before we dig into today's scripture and today's word, let's stop and give the Lord thanks for his faithfulness and for keeping his promises. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we give you thanks that your word that we hear today and every day, that we can have faith and trust in it. For your word that we can find peace and comfort in it. For knowing that what you say, you really mean. For knowing that what it is that you stand for is something that we have worth standing for as well. Lord, you've never failed us. You never will. Thanks be to God for a God who keeps his promises. In Jesus' name, we give thanks for it all. Amen. Amen. You see, in verse 16, it starts off by telling us who it was that was going to Galilee, right? It says that it was the 11 disciples. But I want you to say that slowly with me. Say, 11 disciples. Doesn't quite sound like what we're used to, right? 11, not 12. You see, over time, we got so used to hearing that it was the 12 disciples did this, or Jesus and the 12 disciples did that. Now, we know what happened to our good buddy Judas. I know him very well, as I got to play him 2 years in a row at the Living Last Supper. Some notes I have here, Mike, if you can believe this, and Ed, it says that Judas was the handsome one. But it also says, don't read that aloud. Okay, anyways, so we know what happened to Judas. We know that they're now shorthanded. They are working as a smaller group with 11 disciples. Again, for so long, we are used to hearing that 12. And now what was once familiar to us, what was once familiar to the entire gospel story has changed at this point. That group is now shattered and broken. But fear not, for God can and does use things that are broken. Amen? After all, that's why he sent his Son Jesus Christ in the first place to fix this world that had become broken and shattered. We find ourselves, even today, surrounded by a world that reminds us each and every day just how broken it really is and just how much we need Jesus Christ in our lives. This world that we're living in is full of faults and injustice, sin and pure evil. Until Jesus returns again, this world will continue to be in a state of brokenness. But we've been given a job to do in the meantime, church. We aren't supposed to just throw up our hands and give up and say, well, we might as well just wait for Jesus to come. Just waiting. No, instead, it says in today's word that he has given us a job to do. But before he gave that commission that we'll get to here in a moment. There was something I want to point out in verse 17 that takes place. In verse 17, it says, when they saw him, they worshiped. Amen? Upon experiencing Christ face to face, they did the thing that we should all be doing, right? And that is, they worshiped him. In all of his holiness, in all of his glory, in all of the wonder that surrounds Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, they worshiped him. You see, in this time of uncertainty and civil unrest that we're surrounded with, what's the one thing that we should all continue to do and keep doing in our everyday life? That is worshiping God. We have the ability and the freedom to worship God. When all else fails, worship God. When things are going well, worship God. When the world is falling apart around us and suffocating us with all the evilness and sinfulness that this world has to offer, we are still able to worship God. So let me recap this entire chapter again, chapter 28. The disciples were in a situation at the beginning that was unfamiliar to them. They had lost their Messiah. They had lost their teacher. They were unsure of what was happening. All of a sudden, Jesus was raised from the dead. We see an angel telling the Marys who came to the tomb where to meet him. Jesus then meets them and tells them again where to go into Galilee. Again, this chapter starts with that fulfillment of a promise that Jesus had made with them time and time again leading up to his death. He then makes another promise to meet them in Galilee. So they make it all the way to Galilee, and upon seeing him with their own eyes, experiencing that Christ once again fulfilled his promise, as they worshiped him, the rest of verse 17 comes into play. It says, but some doubted. So even though promise after promise was fulfilled, in the midst of worshiping Jesus Christ face to face, some of the disciples there still had their doubts, even though they were face to face. The topic of doubt is not something new to us in the youth group, as this past spring we did a series called Doubt It, and we learned several things, such as you are not alone in your questions. God doesn't shame us for having questions, and our questions don't always get answered, and that godly people can help us when we do have questions. You see, so some of us, this topic seems very fresh and familiar. But here they were, these disciples, 11 of them, again, 11 of them were worshiping God. And at the same time, some of them doubted. I read a pastor's take on it this week that says they imagine that they came there to a worship service, came with their uncertainties and their hesitations. They took their place and maybe wadded up their bulletin and set disgruntled and unsure of what was happening. Maybe they even mumbled along to the prayers and even skipped some of the parts of the hymns that they sang that day because they didn't fully understand or believe. But the thing to think about that is that they still worshiped, right? They still, even with their doubts, they came before God and worshiped him in all of his glory. So there they were, those disciples, and here we are, disciples. They were worshiping. Today we've been worshiping. Some of them were doubting back then. And maybe some of us today are doubting as well. But I want to reassure you today that it's okay if you have doubts. That God is fully capable of handling our doubts and our questions. God is fully capable of handling our fears and our anxieties. Most importantly about that is the phrase, God is capable. Amen? So here they are, mid-worship, some full of doubt. Jesus explains to them that he has now received all authority in heaven and on earth. So what could possibly be going through the disciples' head at that moment? Jesus gives them this news that he is now back from the dead and he has the authority now. They've experienced Christ in his resurrected form, face to face. They're amazed. They're obeying and following Christ to even get to where they were that day in Galilee. He's there with them. They worship, some doubt. all this is going on, and he tells them he has all authority in heaven and of earth. Imagine the emotional buildup of that day for those disciples, not sure what's going on. They experience death, new life, praise, doubt, and now authority? Now, do they think that Jesus is now going to storm Rome and take over the world with his newfound authority? Think of the possibilities that could have been going through their minds that day. What comes with this authority that God has given Jesus Christ? What is it that could be given to them? But then Jesus tells them something. Something they probably weren't expecting. Sure, they wanted him to get revenge for his horrible, painful death upon a cross. Sure, they wanted to finally take over and rule the entire land with this newfound authority that Jesus had. But that's not what Jesus said. Instead, with all the authority in heaven and on earth, he turns around and gives us, even today, this message is meant for us, and all of his followers, a job. He has given us this great commission. See, these last two verses of this chapter and also of this gospel of Matthew, keep the good news alive. You see, in verse 19 and 20, it says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Look, I myself will be with you every day until the end of this present age." You've heard this before. This is a very familiar scripture. But see, this mission from God that we've all been given is for all of us. And it's meant for all of his people. As you guys know, one of my favorite words in the Bible is the word all. It's inclusive, it counts everyone, leaves no one out. And as we sit and as we watch Satan and his lies manifest in the world today, it's a perfect word for us to focus on, all. Especially as this week is Peace and Justice Sunday. A Sunday for us to focus on the peace that is given from Christ and the justice that is given for his people. We are agents of that peace and justice. And if we look to this commission to baptize and preach the gospel to all nations, then this would never be an issue. Because we are including all people in all that we do for the sake of the gospel. You see, what better way to spread this peace and justice than to be doing the work that we've already been called to do, church? To go and to make disciples. To go and to make disciples of all nations. Not just nations that are filled with people who look and think and talk just like you. Not just of nations that are close by and convenient to access. And not just nations that are open and welcoming to new visitors either, but rather all nations. We are being sent out to not just tell people who Jesus is, for even the devil himself knows who Jesus is, but we are sent out to teach them how to live like Jesus and how to love like Jesus and how to do the work of Jesus Christ. To show them how they too can live a life of peace that is only found in Jesus. And to give a life of justice that is available for all people as Jesus has called us to do. You see, Jesus already did the hard part, folks. Now we've been given a free gift to pass on from generation to generation. Another favorite phrase of mine, whether it's in the Bible or not, is the word free. Free is good, right? This gift that Jesus gave to us is free. So why not pass it on to someone else? It's ours to have and it's ours to give away. And Jesus tells us that in order to make disciples, we have to do a few things. To baptize them in the name of the Trinity, which it's also Trinity Sunday. So baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But to teach them, and he says, importantly, teach them to obey and keep with them everything that he has commanded us. Not just this part, not just that part, but everything he has commanded us to do. That love, that compassion that Jesus shows, we are to do the same, church. And the best part about it is that we don't have to do it alone. right? We're going back to the promises here now. Last week, Pentecost Sunday, Christ fulfilled this promise that he mentions at the end. So in verse 20, when he says, I myself will be with you every day until the end of the present age, we know this to be true. This is the promise that ends today's scripture in this part of the gospel, that we would never, ever be alone. Remember, I said that this chapter started with a fulfillment of a promise, that he was going to die and rise in 3 days, and he did that. And just like that, he goes on to fulfill this promise. In the book of Acts chapter 2, we see the Holy Spirit come down upon them on that Pentecost day. So through this Holy Spirit that was sent, Christ is with us, just as he promised, until the end of the present age. Praise be to God that keeps his promises. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He has kept them all, and we have faith that he'll continue to keep his promises. Church, today we are faced in a world that is hurting so bad. We are living in a time where there is nothing but brokenness around us, it seems. But we know that we have the power of the Holy Spirit with us to do something about it. Earlier I said, but fear not, for God can and does use things that are broken. I know in my own life, he has used myself, once broken, constantly broken person, to do the work that he has called us to do. And I know he's called you as well, for he has called us all to the same commission, the same job that we all have, to help this broken world. This world is crying out, you know that. So there's still work to be done for all nations to hear about the good news, to all nations to be transformed by this good news. In the midst of the world that is fearful and has no hope, we, the church, have hope. And it is our time and our turn to go out and give it to those who need it most. Let us pray. Father God, we pause this moment to give you thanks for your word that never fails us, your word that leads us down the path we need to go. Let us look for ways to fulfill this commission that you've given to us. Let us not turn a blind eye to the injustice that we see around us, but instead be an agent of change, an agent of hope, and an agent of peace. Lord, be with us as we process what it is you've called us to do, as you've not only challenged us, but equipped us through your Holy Spirit. Lord, we give you thanks this day. Amen. Church, we are looking forward to seeing you in the coming weeks, and we pray that for safety and for wellness for everyone who can come and attend and be a part of these services. While things look a little different when you come back, just remember that God never changes, that the mission he has given us hasn't changed either. So go, therefore, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and be blessed. We'll see you soon.